My name is Vincent Noël, and I'm a researcher in the Computational Systems Biology of Cancer team at Institut Curie. And I'm working, mainly with MABOS and Boolean models. And so today I will present you some introduction to MABOS ID and how to use it. So first, what I want to explain today is what's the goal and why we are modeling biological system. Then I will present you MABOS, which is a continuous time Boolean modeling framework. So I will also explain what that means. Then I will explain, I will present you one example that we will get to do again on WebMABOS. Then I will present you another example on Arnau model of prostate. And that example we will do with PyMABOS, so the Python bindings of MABOS. But first, why do we want to model biological system? So the first idea is to summarize what is known and published most of the time about a process. But it's also to understand which mechanism specifically are deregulated in disease and why, or also in the case of drug treatment, what are the exact mechanisms which are impacted by these drug treatments. It's also to be able to identify possible points of intervention, to be able to take these disease phenotypes and revert them back to normal phenotypes, and so to anticipate the effects of drugs. And finally, it's also to be able to optimize efficacy of treatments and minimize side effects. So what are the example of questions that we can solve with our modeling approach? So such example are, what are the process which are activated in high-grade tumor in colon? Or should we treat all medulloblastoma patients with the same drugs? Or also, can we understand the differentiation of immune cells? Or can the response of drug treatment for breast cancer patients be predicted? So here, we see that we have some really targeted and advanced queries, which are linked to either patients or groups of patients or type of cancer. And so I will show you some really brief example of personalization, but I will try to keep it simple since, again, it's an introductory course. But first, let's talk about modeling framework. So we mainly have two types of modeling framework to be able to model biological system. The first one would be the quantitative. So here we have a description which is a lot more fine the qualitative one, because values can be any quantity. We don't have what we want to represent in this framework type of frameworks would be, for example, concentration of some protein inside the cell or quantities of proteins. It also has a continuous time, so that you're able to really get the state of the system at any time point. And you will have like a gradual, like here for this orange variable, a gradual decrease of the this specific value. The problem of quantitative frameworks is that they are difficult to write. We have to know math a lot more. And we also have to play with a lot more parameters. And so, because also of this complexity and mainly because of parameters and complex math formula, it's also difficult to simulate large model. Up to a certain number of variables, it gets really tricky to be able to do it efficiently. The other framework, which is a lot more simpler, is the qualitative one. So here we don't have values which are real values, we only have Booleans. So values are only true or false. Here you can see that values will be either one or zero. We also don't have a notion of time. So we just have a sequence of events, but we don't know, for example, if this event between zero and one will last 5 minutes or 2 hours, or even if the next event between one and two will last the same duration as the previous one. So we just have a sequence of events. The main advantage of this qualitative framework is that it's really easy to write. it's mainly Boolean formulas, so logical formulas that can make a lot more sense to us intuitively than quantitative models. And it's also able to simulate very large models with a big number of variables. So let's start with some very simple example of a biological system. Suppose we have a three-variable system. A, which is an input node, so we will be able to set the value of this node at the beginning of a simulation. And then A will activate B, but C will only get activated if both A and B are inactivated. So how should we represent this kind of system with the different frameworks? So first, the quantitative approach, which is mainly ordinary differential equations. So here, we would have to write kinetic rates for all of these variables, so derivatives. So for A, like I said, A is an input. A will be defined at the beginning of a simulation and won't evolve anymore during the simulation. So its derivative is equal to zero, meaning no change will happen during time. For B, like I said, B will depend on A. And so if A is active, B will be active. So the derivative of B will depend on the value of A and of some kinetic parameter to say if the activation of B will be fast or slow compared to with respect to time. And finally, we have the derivative for C, which in this case is a negative because both nodes exert a negative influence on C. And it depends on both the value of A, the value of B, but also the value of C. And so, like I said, this already is kind of trickier, and this is really simple examples. And so to be able to simulate this model, we also need to define some initial values. So for example, now we will take A at 1, B at 0, and C at 1. And so what will happen if we simulate such a system? We will have, so here I'm only plotting B and C since A is staying constant during the simulation. It will always be 1, so it's not that interesting to plot. So what will happen first is that B will start to get activated progressively. And as B gets activated, then this both node will be active and exerts a negative influence on C. So C will get slowly inactivated. So here again, you see that you have a real notion of time. If you want to have the state of a simulation at time 1.5, for example, you can see the value here. And we also have continuous values. So what would be the alternative if we use qualitative formalism, like Boolean formulas? So the formulas, like I said, will be simple. A will be equal to 1 because it's the value that we choose at first. Then B will be equal to A, like A exerts a positive influence of B, so the formula of B depends only on the node A. And C will receive negative influence of both nodes. So either we have negative A or negative B. So again, as initial values, we'll take the same one. So A will be true, B will be false, and C will be true. So we get the exact same example I showed you before. So we start with C at 1 and B at 0. We don't show A again because it's constant. And at first, so B will activate at time step 1. And then at time step 2, C will deactivate. And then it will reach this stable value. So now I want to present you MaBoS, which is another type of framework, which is kind of in between these two frameworks. And it's a continuous time Boolean modeling. So this was introduced by Gauthier, Laurence, Eric, and Emmanuel a few years ago, already 10 years ago, with this paper about continuous time Boolean modeling for biological signaling. And it's an application of Gillespie algorithm. So what does MaBoS stand for? MaBoS is a Markovian Boolean stochastic simulator. So First, it's Boolean. So most of the time, we want to just describe the system as a set of Boolean formulas. It's also stochastic, meaning that we can have multiple simulations and they won't always give the same result. It's also able to handle physical time. And this is one of the main differences with a normal Boolean framework. And that's why it's about continuous time Boolean modeling. We won't have just a sequence of events. We'll have a real notion of physical time inside our simulation that we can map then to experiments or other type of model, which also use physical time. And so since we have physical time, we also have some kinetic parameters and which allow us to handle different timescale processes. Like suppose you want to be able to represent a process of transcription or phosphorylation, the timescales are not the same at all. Phosphorylation will be really quick and transcription will take more time. And so we are able to set some kinetic rates to be able to say that this node will be activated quickly because it's a phosphorylation, or the other one will be activated slowly because it's transcription. So Mabos, we think, will fill this gap between ODEs and Boolean modeling, trying to combine the best of both worlds. So trying to still be simple and write Boolean formulas, but also having some precision, some accuracy, and a notion of physical time. So how does it work? So Mabos, what does it do exactly? It simulates transition from one Boolean network state to another using a mathematical construct called the Markov chain. So basically what do? Is we start with some initial state of a system. So like I showed you before, just set up a system with one and zero at first. And then we'll simulate evolution of this system one node at a time, with time. And then at some point in our simulation, in Mabos, it will be linked to a maximum time of simulation that you set, the network will stop. Or maybe sometimes the network won't be able to evolve more and it will also reach the final state before this max time is reached. So we do this not one time, but several times. First, because we have some possibility to have different initial states, not start only from one initial state, but have multiple initial states for multiple simulation. But also because all of these transitions can be stochastic. Like I told you, nodes will be activated one at a, inactivated or activated one at a time. So we are not sure that even starting from the same initial state will reach the same state at the second stage. So this allows us to also introduce some heterogeneity and to be able to see what are all the possible evolution of a system. So this transition from one node to another is governed by this formula, where we have two different types of rates. One rate is for the inactivation of a node. So if the node value is inactive, then the transition rate will depend on its rate of activation. And inversely, if the node is already active, then the transition rate will be its rate of inactivation. And so again, all these transitions are stochastic. So potentially, all of these trajectories can be different. And so what we do is we simulate a lot of them. And then from this set of simulated trajectories, we can compute mean trajectories and we can obtain probabilities per state over time. So let's go back to the example that I showed you before, but this time with continuous time Boolean modeling. So it's like I said, we have activation rate and inactivation rate. And this will be need to define for both, but we have some very simple way to define them. So first, A will have a rate of activation of one, which means it can be activated, but a rate of inactivation of zero, meaning it cannot be inactivated. So once we start with the value one, it will stay at one. Then for B and C, we have a different writing that I need to introduce first, which is this type of writing. So here, what it means for this rate up of B is that if A, then the rate will be 1. Otherwise, the rate will be 0. So basically, it's just an if-else written in a different form, meaning that if the node A is active, then the activation rate of B will be 1, meaning it can get activated. But if A is not active, then the rate will be 0, so it cannot get activated. And for the rate down of B, we have a very similar thing, but with the two rates opposite, meaning that if B is already active, then the rate which will be important will be this rate, the rate to inactivate it. And so if A is active, then the rate of inactivation will be 0. But if the node A is inactive, then the rate of inactivation of B will be 1, meaning that if A gets inactivated, then B gets also inactivated. And we have something very similar for this node C, except that this time the condition that we are checking is if either A is inactive or B is inactive. So as you can see, it's not that different from Boolean formulas, because in the end, what will really matter is this logical formula here that you see E repeated, you see it repeated here and here, both in the up and down formula. And then it will just depend between the up and down rates, these two values. So here for the activation, it could be 1 or 0. And for the inactivation, it could be 0 or 1. And as you can see, it's the same thing for C. So meaning that from a simple Boolean models, we are able to improve this formalism to be able to add kinetic rates this way. So then we'll again try to simulate this system. So we will start with initial values A will be 1, true, B will be false, and C will be true. And so first also, let me introduce the type of files that we are using to represent our models. So again, MABOS model is defined mainly by its inactivation and activation rates. So here, for example, we have a definition of a node A. So like I said, the rate of activation is 1 and the rate of inactivation is 0. And we also have a node B, where here we actually define a logical formula, which will be the formula, the Boolean formula of this node. And then we are using this logical formula inside the same type of construct that I showed you before. That if A is true, then B will be able to get activated with this kinetic rate, like variable starting with a dollar will be parameters that I will show you before. After, and if A is not active, then the rate of inactivation is 0. Here also we kept it simple. If B node is active, it cannot get inactivated, so it's 0. And so for C, again, we define a logical formula, which is not A or not B. And the rate of activation will depend on this logical formula and also on some other parameters. And the rate of inactivation of C will follow the same type of formula, but this time with the two values inverted. So if this formula is true, then we don't inactivate it. But if it's false, then we can inactivate it with this rate. So as you can see in this description of the kinetic rate of activation and inactivation, we can put some complex cases. These are still really simple, but we can put a lot of formulas which are a lot bigger. But we can also just stick to very simple one where we just use basically the Boolean formulas that we define with some default value for the rates. So like I said, we also have the possibility to use parameters inside this rate, which will be defined in the simulation settings that we'll show you later. And we can also use other types of Boolean models formats, such as SBML, QL, or BNet. So basically what MABOS will do is that it will use the Boolean formula inside this type of model to just fill the logic part. And then the rate up will be basically like this with some default value for the activation and inactivation. And so this is the other file, the CFG files, which are the simulation settings. So here you can set several things. Like first, you can set the initial state of nodes, showing that if, for example, here we define A as being true at the initial state and B at false and C as true. We can also make some more complex definition that I'm not showing here, which would be stochastic. We can, for example, say that A will be active 50% of the time and inactive 50% of the time. We also have a notion of internal or output variables. So the idea is that if we want to simulate a model and show the result for all the nodes, every state of the model will be a combination of nodes. And so we can have, if we have a lot of nodes, some very large number of possible states because of all the combinatorial inside with due to the number of possible nodes. So it's really important and really interesting to be able to hide some values, to just focus on some specific nodes which are output of a model. And so if we want to just hide some nodes of a result, we can just define them as internal inside this setting file. We can also, like I said before, define some parameters. So here, for example, we define the activation rate of B and activation rate of C, which were used before in the definition of the activation and inactivation rates. And so here, for example, the activation of B will be faster than the activation of C. And finally, we also have some simulation settings, like the maximum time of simulation, like I showed you. We also have a sample count. Like, remember these slides here. We are computing multiple trajectories and then doing statistics on this set of trajectories. So the sample count is this number of individual trajectories from which your result will be computed. And we also have other settings which are more technical, like which kind of random generator we want to use, or how many number of cores do we want to use. So this is the example of result that we obtain with this model. So like I said, at first, we start with C at 1 and B at 0. With time, like I said again here, the activation of B will be faster than the activation of B will be faster than the activation of C. So first, B start to get activated really quickly. And so the state C will go down, and the main state of the system will become the common activation of the node B and the node C. And after some point, this state will also go down because the C node will get inactivated. And here you see that the main state in the end of the system will be just the B node active, and the BC state where both nodes are active will go to zero, and the state where only C is active will also go to zero. We can also look at this result in a different way, which is closer to the one I showed you in the introduction, where we just look at the values of the nodes B and C. Here we were looking at states, which are really like composition of multiple state of nodes. But we can just look at the value of the nodes. So here we start again at 1 for the C node and B for the 0 for the B nodes. We first activate B and then slowly we inactivate C. One other type of result that we can print is the final state distribution. So like I showed you before in this slide, the final state of the system here will be that most of the individual simulation will have the B node active and C inactive, and a few will have still some states where B and C are active. So here we can see exactly the same thing. We see that 98.7% of the time the nodes will be just B as active, but for some trajectories, the simulation time won't be long enough to inactivate all the C nodes. And this is an important point. Like for Boolean modeling, we sometimes talk about steady states, which would be the state of a system after no evolution is possible anymore. With Mabos, we are talking more about final states, which means the states of a system at the end of our max time simulation time. So ideally, if we want to have steady state, we will need to put a max time equal to infinity and to simulate as long as it needs to be able to reach the steady state. But for practicity, we never do this, and we just take a time long enough so that most of the individual simulation will have reached steady state.